Even a man who is pure in heart and says his prayers by night may become a wolf when the wolfbane blooms and the autumn moon is bright. This popular rhyme was coined in the 1941 film The Wolfman, which subsequently gave rise to what many consider to be the modern-day werewolf, a man cursed by a gypsy and who sports the mark of the devil on his palm. So, under the light of the full moon, he transforms into a wild, rabid wolfman, with his only weakness being silver. But beware, the story goes, as anyone who is bitten by the werewolf will become a werewolf themselves. Generally, it is considered that most of what Kurt Sittmig, writer of The Wolfman, wrote is just fiction. Werewolves, according to most folklore and legend, can't be killed by silver, they do not change by moonlight, the curse is not spread through a bite, and they certainly do not have the devil's mark on their palm. Or do they? As incorrect as many believe the writer to be, there are in fact some parts of this fiction which can be found in folklore. The word werewolf was first written down in 1020 as Werewolf. The word derives from two separate branches, were, which means man, as in male, not human, and wolf, which could mean either wolf or beast. However, 1020 wasn't the first time people had named nor believed in werewolves. It simply marked the first recorded point in time when the word had in fact been written down. The definition of a werewolf is simple enough and goes hand in hand with the word. A man or woman, often witches or sorcerers, with the ability to transform into savage wolves. In history, they were formidable and dangerous monsters to be hunted and killed on sight, and for good reason, as the werewolf was known to have a taste for human flesh, children in particular. This fact is heavily reflected in fairy tales, although they do have a more symbolic meaning in those stories. The consumption of human flesh, though, is a consistency in werewolf mythology and folklore, and this fact is no more plain than in what is considered to be the oldest werewolf myth, the legend of Lycaon. The story goes that long ago in Greece, mighty Zeus came down from the heavens to enjoy a wonderful feast with King Lycaon, a well-loved king who in turn showed great admiration for Zeus. But Lycaon was doubtful of the god, and so, to test if Zeus was truly all-knowing, he murdered one of his sons and served his entrails as a main course. Zeus, of course, saw through this disgusting trick and flipped the table, furious. He spun on Lycaon and placed a spell on the king, turning him into a wolf for the rest of his days. And he bestowed that same curse upon all of Lycaon's sons. And so the first werewolf ran away into the forests and straight into our legends and nightmares. The story, of course, has many variations, but death and sacrifice is usually present, and the consumption of human flesh becomes a staple for werewolf myths. This becomes a sort of trial they must fight against, resisting the urge to eat humans. This idea is also littered throughout werewolf myths. The word Lycaon actually derives from the Greek word lycan in Greece, which does mean wolf, but Lycaon would be an example of an involuntary werewolf. These are men or women who become werewolves through either mistake, bad luck, or just stupidity. They are usually cursed by angry witches or angry gods. And there are numerous examples of these in folklore and legend. Being born during a full moon is a sure way to receive the curse, as well as being the seventh or eighth son. Sleeping under a full moon could also turn one into a werewolf, as well as being born on either Easter, Christmas, or any other specific days in the year. Other examples of involuntary werewolves would be found in Portugal, where men or women go to a crossroads and transforms into werewolves under a full moon. They are sensitive to light and can be heard making sobbing noises as they run through the valleys and hills. When faced with one of these beasts, it takes a simple spark of a match to frighten them off. Another example would be in Italy, where there is a story of a man who draws a circle around himself, takes off his clothes, and under the light of the full moon, takes the form of a wolf. I have tried this, it doesn't work. But a common theme most of you must have noticed is the presence of the moon. And yes, the moon does play a large part in folklore. Sittmek wasn't that far off. He embellished a little, certainly, but there is a clear connection to the moon in folklore. But for the people of medieval Europe, the involuntary werewolf was not their biggest problem. These creatures still tried, at least, to resist their natures. No, the people were more afraid of the voluntary werewolves. Those crazy people who made pacts and deals with red-skinned, horned, and cloven-hoofed locals. What a marvelous idea. In the 16th century, the small town of Bedburg was terrorized by such a werewolf. The animal had killed many a woman and children, some of which had not only been raped and killed, but also partially eaten. For over 25 years, this terror ravaged the countryside, until finally in 1589, he was caught in a hunt. The hunt took the men over hills and through valleys. The wolf was large and powerful and swift, but as it ran through a small thicket, men who had eyes on the beast saw something astonishing. The animal shifted, turning into a man, Stubby Peter. He was arrested, and without much provocation, Peter confessed to not only killing over 18 people, but also to being a werewolf. He claimed he had made a deal with the devil, and he specifically requested to be able to work his malice on men, women, and children in the shape of a beast. The beast shape was requested so that he could always outrun his hunters and never be caught. Seeing as he was eventually caught, though, I do believe he might have some grounds to sue the devil. He said the devil had given him a belt, and when he put it on, Stubby Peter was turned into a werewolf. This is actually quite common in the werewolf folklore. Despite the connection with the moon in certain folklore, the werewolf's transformation was rarely through something as simple as moonlight. Instead, they were granted a gift by the devil. This could be a belt, a girdle, a pelt, or even an ointment to rub on the skin. These pelts and girdles gave them strength, cunning, and speed. Power was at the heart of it, and as long as they wore the item, they could transform into a wolf. However, we do need to note a very interesting theme here, that of devil worship. Once again, in the Wolfman, the werewolf is marked by the pentagram on the palm. Fair enough, it's not exactly the same, but it gives the same message. Here is the sign of the devil on his hand. Thus, it is his handiwork. So again, we have a connection to dark magic, the devil, and evil by association. But why associate something like a werewolf with the devil in particular? From what we can tell from the earlier stories, the werewolf was usually a tragic figure that had made a horrible mistake. How did they go from tragic to plain evil? Simple. The werewolf actually stems from old pagan beliefs. In Norway and Iceland, there was an old belief that humans could take up the strength and cunning of animals. There was also something known as wolf shirts. These were called Ulfahamir, and the werewolf themselves were called Vargir. This later changed into Varulf to include another well-known shapeshifter, the Berserkers, a warrior in Scandinavia who would run naked into the battlefield swinging all three his swords, was possibly considered a sort of werebear. The term berserker could either mean bear, as in naked, or it could derive from the word pelt, or it could actually mean bear, as in the bear. It was believed they called upon the rage and power of the bear during battle, which gave them their ability to fight so tenaciously. The pelt here once again plays a part in transformation, and this is possibly where the idea derived from that men could turn into werewolves through wearing a pelt. But these stories became warped in the new religion, that of Christianity, and became a sort of witchcraft, because it was unnatural. It went against everything the Bible taught. These were women or men who had made a pact with the devil to gain power, and they were out for the souls of the innocent. To drive out a witch was to save a whole town. In werewolf myths and folklore, the werewolf is considered to be such a man, a person who turns his back on Christianity to make a pact with the devil to transform into the dreaded wolf for his own selfish gain. These men were often called sorcerers, and their crimes were usually quite brutal. To make it clear, most werewolves in folklore and myths are men. This is most probably because men are physically stronger than women, and also far more prone to violence and vile tempers. In turn, witches are more often than not women, probably because women can be quite cunning and would often use their beauty to manipulate and bewitch men for their own personal gain. And this could be seen as a sort of witchcraft. So most werewolves were men, and most women were witches. Apart from the pentagram on the hand, there were other ways to recognize the werewolf. Thick unibrows, hairy hands, red eyes, or even tails. One theory said that the hair of a werewolf, while in the human shape, was in fact inverse and grew under the skin. A man was taken under the scalpel to test that theory, but he did not survive the procedure. There were, of course, other werewolves in Europe. Jacques Roulet was a werewolf from France. He had killed and eaten a teenage boy, and Roulet was found not too far away from the body, wounded and half naked. He was arrested on suspicion and soon confessed he had a salve or ointment that had been given to him which could turn him into a wolf. Roulet had made it clear that the boy had not been his first victim. Although tried and found guilty, the people felt more sorry for Roulet, believing him to be mentally ill, and he was instead committed to an asylum. This is also a quite common theme in werewolf stories. Many people convicted of werewolves were rather shown mercy than outright scorn. Another wolf from France was Gilles Garnier, who had killed numerous children before being hunted and spotted in wolf form. They claimed the wolf had in some way resembled Garnier, a hermit who lived nearby. After another child went missing, Garnier and his wife were arrested. A staggering 50 people testified against the man, and he was tortured to find out the truth. He confessed to being a werewolf, claiming he hunted and killed children who wandered into the woods, and he even shared the meat with his wife. Garnier was burned at the stake in January 1573. What is interesting to note is that despite people being burned at the stake or killed as werewolves, churches actually rejected the idea of men being able to change their shape. It was considered almost blasphemous to consider that God's creation could be changed according to the devil's whim. Another part of werewolf myths is that they are weak to silver. Truth be told, the only place I can think would be in the mythology of hares. Witches were often associated with hares, and of course the ability to transform into them. One old myth goes, the only way to kill a witch in hare form was to shoot it with a silver bullet, which is why many hunters in the old days carried silver bullets. As for the bite which infects the victim, there really isn't any sort of folklore or myth that a bite can turn you into a werewolf. This is purely fiction. Cures for werewolves range from quite a few stories as well. One included saying a person's Christian name 3 times, another says the only way to cure a werewolf is to give it wolf's bane, and another would be to swim in a specific lake. And also, abstaining from human flesh is another popular one. However, this would not be a werewolf discussion if I did not at the very least mention the affliction of lycanthropy. This is a mental illness in which the sufferer believes him or herself to be a wolf. They will crawl on all fours, they will howl and bark and eat raw meat. In all likeness, they act and believe themselves to be wolves. I have heard and read numerous times that many considered lycanthropy to be the origin of werewolf beliefs. People back then, many would say, did not understand afflictions of the mind and did not comprehend that these were simply ill people. This would make sense. However, even as early as the 15th or 14th centuries, did people quite clearly distinguish between werewolves and lycanthropes. Montagu Summers covers this in his book, The Werewolf in Lore and Legend, and shows that lycanthropes were considered tragic figures, with wounded, scratched up legs, who shook and barked and were generally quite upsetting to see. Also, cures for lycanthropes were far different than those for werewolves, and included rest, milk, and generally just kindness. So no, I don't believe people saw lycanthropy sufferers as werewolves. By their own admission, there was, or at least is, a difference. So of course the final question that we need to ask. Did werewolves exist? This one I will leave up for the judges. Honestly, I just don't know. In my time studying the lore and mythology of werewolves, I was both fascinated and stricken by the true fear and terror these people shared for something as vile as a werewolf. On top of being afraid of the witch and her wicked ways, the natural wolf in turn was not a kindly, sweet animal. They were aggressive, dangerous animals that were feared. Quite a few records in history show wolves not only attacking people, but doing so in large packs and quite aggressively, like the wolves of Paris, for example, which were tenacious and determined, killing dozens of people before being stoned and killed. At one point, the wolf problem was so great that they were driven to extinction on the British Isles by order of the king. So the wolf in of itself was already a terrifying prospect. So now picture the idea that a wolf was not only powerful, was not only dangerous and aggressive, but also as intelligent as a man, and out for the blood of a town's inhabitants. This would be a nightmare. The werewolf, though, was a twofold symbol. On the one hand, they were representatives of a very real fear of wolves. On the other hand, they represented a far more symbolic fear of the evil in the world. The greatest enemy of the lamb, after all, according to the Bible, was the wolf. So the devil would have played a large role in such a devilish creature. We can also see this connection in fairy tales. They even took the symbol of sexual predators. In Red Riding Hood or the 7 Little Goats, you can see this quite clearly. So it could very well be that werewolves may have been the symbolic representation of the reprehensible state of man when he falls so far from grace. Instead of having the human be a monster, rather turn him into a monster so that we don't have to admit that people can be so evil on their own. But beyond that, there are numerous other were creatures to be found in the world, from were tigers to India, to were leopards and were hyenas in Africa, and even were sharks from Hawaii. The idea of a man changing into an animal is a real fear amongst many people from many different cultures and beliefs. And like the werewolf, these monsters are often spawned from fear, with not always a direct influence from Christianity. The people of Europe believed in them as wholeheartedly as they believed in the dangers of plague or the protection of a cross. And at the very least, we do too. Despite the years upon years of scientists and biologists declaring that werewolves should be left in the box of myths and fakery, our own curiosity and small hope still draws us to them. We want them to be real. We want them to live in dark places, to chase humans, to devour them and howl at the red moon with full bellies. But before, people ran from werewolf in fear and disgust. And now, we seem to be chasing the werewolf instead. the prey becoming the hunter, seeking them in every corner of every story and forest, hoping against hope that the monster that terrorized Europe for hundreds of years is as real as we are. And that's it for The Werewolf. Thank you all so much for watching The Mythoscope. This week I will be recommending Montagu Summers' Werewolf in Lore and Legend. It's a very good book. I would recommend getting a Latin translator and a Greek translator though, because not all the texts are actually translated, but it was absolutely instrumental for me in researching this video, and I'm sure anyone who likes Werewolf will get a big kick out of this book. Thank you all so much for watching, and have an awesome week, guys.